Well, good morning, Selby Pastoral Charge, and welcome to this time of worship for August 29th, 2021. Well, my son Max and I are off on one last adventure before the start of school and the beginning of Sunday morning church in the coming weeks. You may remember this location from a year ago at this time. We're at Puzzle Lake Provincial Park, and last year we set off from this parking area to find ourselves an interior camping site for a time of renewal before the busyness of the fall season. Renewal is an essential theme in the Bible. In fact, you might say that it's what the whole Bible is about. Throughout history, God brings renewal to God's people, making his presence known and by the power of the Holy Spirit, guiding God's people to holiness and faithfulness. The Apostle Paul says, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. So today, let the renewal begin as we come before God with our worship. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you are my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Let's sing together. Puzzle Lake Provincial Park is a large park about 10 kilometers north of Tamworth. It's a place most people have never heard of or even been to, and that's because it's a non-operating park, meaning there's no signs or amenities or programs. It's just a wild and beautiful land, a place to get away from, well, pretty much everything. To enter the park, we've just paddled across a small lake called Gull Lake, and we'll be portaging our gear over this large hill, and then entering the lakes on the other side. You can't book campsites ahead of time here, so we're hoping for the best as we head into this unknown land. We're unplugging from culture and entering into the solitude and awareness of God. It'll just be us and the wild animals for a couple of days. And God's powerful presence, of course. So as we begin this morning, let's come before God with prayer. Renewing God, many of us are preparing to begin something new in September. School, work, projects, etc. We'll be heading into a time that is unpredictable. So renew us today in your presence. Help us to step away from the toxicity of a world that does not know you or where it is going. Help us to be your alternative community of love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it's been a while since Jill Story has joined us in our online services, but we're so glad to have her with us today. So here's Jill Story singing one of her favorites, Daddy's Hands.
I remember Daddy's hands folded silently in prayer and reaching out to hold me when I had a nightmare. You could read quite a story in the calluses and lines. Years of work and worry had left their mark behind. I remember Daddy's hands, how they held my mama tight and patted my back. Something's done right. There are things that I've forgotten that I loved about the man, but I'll always remember the love in Daddy's hands. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands. I remember Daddy's hands working till they bled, sacrificed unselfishly just to keep us all fed. If I could do things over, I'd live my life again and never take for granted the love in Daddy's hands. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands. There was always love in Daddy's hands.
All right, well, now we're settled in at our campsite. We found just the perfect spot, and as you can see, we have some shelter, which will be handy because they're calling for thunderstorms later on today. Well, now it's my time to speak directly to our young people, and I wonder, are you guys excited about getting back to school in about a week or so? It'll be great to see friends and to be able to hang out again and get back into a routine after so long away. But I know that for lots of kids, going back to school might be a time of worry or anxiety. Over the last year and a half with COVID-19 pandemic, we've been told that it's better to be apart than to be together. Well, I'm going to talk a little bit about that starting next week with a new sermon series called Better Together. But one of the jobs that Jesus gives his followers is to be people who bring renewal to gatherings. What's renewal? Well, Max and I are enjoying a time of renewal right now. We've gotten away from the everyday life and we're using this time to rest and to relax. So we'll be having more energy for whatever's going to come next. I hope you guys have had a chance to get some renewal this summer. But Jesus calls us to a different kind of renewal. Jesus gave us the Holy Spirit who lives in our hearts so that we can have the power of love that we need to show the world a different way of being human. Jesus' followers are not to be followers of the pack, because sometimes the pack, well, it can't be so nice. Have you ever had a bully or someone kind of mean in your class? And you see how people join into that and it makes people feel good to be kind of cruel like that. Well, as followers of Jesus, we're not to be like that. Jesus calls us to be different. Jesus wants us to share the Holy Spirit's power of renewal by building other people up, not by tearing people down. Now, that can be easy enough when we're talking about our friends and our family. But Jesus wants us to bring renewal to the whole world. But how can we do that? Well, what if it was really simple? What if we could bring Jesus' love, the power of the Holy Spirit, into our lives by simply smiling more, or being gracious and loving to people we don't even know? What if we could go out of our way to encourage people when we see something, somebody doing a good thing or something we appreciate about somebody? If we went out of our way to tell them how much we appreciate them, you know, that might just change the whole world in a way by the power of the Holy Spirit. Well, that's just a couple of simple ways that Jesus wants us to bring renewal in this time. And he does it through us, which is pretty amazing. People who follow Jesus should be just a little bit different from others, because we want to show and to share the love of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit with everyone we meet. All right, it's time for us to sing. So let's sing kind of a fun song. I got an old church choir. Let's sing together. Today, we're in the final week of our sermon series called Hidden Power. And for today, we're looking at how the hidden power of the Holy Spirit brings renewal, not only to ourselves, but to our whole communities. So here's Cal, one of our confirmands, sharing the Word of God with us today.
Today, I'm reading for the letter of Ephesians, church beginning at chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, for whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, now let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come so that we might hear what you have for us today. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Over the last 4 weeks, we've been unpacking the hidden power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We've heard how the Spirit's first act is always to draw us into a family, a community, a church. And then the Holy Spirit becomes our guide, leading us through life's blessings and challenges. And finally, the Holy Spirit uses God's hidden power to begin the slow and steady work of making us more like Jesus by bringing forth the fruit of the Spirit in us. Well, today we're pulling all of that together with a kind of 30,000-foot view of the Holy Spirit's power at work in the world. I recently heard a pastor and author named Mark Sayers from Melbourne, Australia, tell a story about something that happened to his church a couple of years ago. It was Easter Sunday, the most important Sunday in the church year. As he approached the church on that sacred Sunday morning, something unusual caught his attention. As he pulled into the church parking lot, he saw a large sheet covering the church's front doors. As he approached and peeked under the sheet and discovered that vandals had spray-painted in brazen, bold block letters, a note stuck to the wall explained that the sheet was the charitable work of a Catholic priest and some of his church members from the parish across the street, who had attempted to wash the paint, and when they couldn't get it off, they found a sheet to cover it. They had noticed the vandalism as they headed into their early morning mass and came to the Protestant church's rescue. The pastor thought, who would do such a thing on Easter morning of all times? It felt like the secular moment had reached into our time of celebration with a message of pointed discouragement. I was already disheartened, he recalled, concerned about the mood evident in the wider culture, the growing fractious cultural landscape of constant controversy, in which Christianity seemed to be dragged through the mud in continual crisis, at times being targeted and other times wounding itself, a mood that now reached the front doors of our own church. The joy and gratitude that I had felt anticipating this Resurrection Sunday service evaporated. I wondered who I should call to deal with the problem. Most people were probably in the midst of their Easter Sunday breakfast, about to get dressed and head to church. Maybe some servant-hearted volunteer would come to my aid. Then the nudge from the Holy Spirit. Mark, stop. I want you to deal with this. Paint the doors. So an hour before hundreds of Easter worshipers would be filing in those very doors, I was rummaging around the dark and dusty storage shed looking for a can of paint. As I began to paint, my harried, angry state began to dissipate. I settled into the gentle and rhythmic brushwork. The sun broke through the clouds, warming the back of my neck. I felt the Spirit nudge me again, encouraging me to pray for the person or people who had vandalized our doors. I asked God to reach out and to touch them, to reveal himself to them in their pain and anger. The sense that this was an evil secular assault began to disappear. Again, I read the note left by the Catholic priest. I began to marvel that he and his parishioners had spent their Easter morning trying to scrub paint from our doors, locating a sheet to cover the expletive. Something continued to shift in me. Here in this moment of antagonism, in the midst of the insult of my faith, God had drawn Catholics to serve Protestants. An Easter moment of grace, a show of Christian unity that no program or event could ever manufacture. What other gifts and blessings lay hidden, waiting to be discovered in this moment, I wondered. I think this story beautifully illustrates the power of the Holy Spirit. God's power brought God's family together in love and service, Catholics serving Protestants, and God's power led Pastor Mark to action, and in that action, God's power changed his very heart, bringing forth Christ-like fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, and so on. This is the hidden power of the Holy Spirit. I don't know about you, but these days I feel a tremendous sense of heaviness in the air. I grieve for our culture. We're increasingly a divided and angry bunch, and an intense season of political wrangling is not going to help anything. Ours is a culture that values personal opinion, even above our relationship with one another. We're a culture that lives with a new kind of restrictive moralism. We've abandoned much of institutional and foundational wisdom of the past, and instead value individual freedom above all else. It's hard to know what to do. I can feel hopeless and discouraged to be living in such a time. So personally, I'm praying for renewal. I'm praying for the power of the Holy Spirit to come and do what the Holy Spirit has done so many times before. For a couple of centuries, there has been something called the myth of progress at work in our secular age. It's the idea that over time, civilization will naturally get better and better. It's the belief that as science and technology improve, as education and the arts become more accessible, there will be a kind of renaissance, and our whole society will get better. It's the idea that borrows from Christianity, in a sense. But it's essentially the promise of the kingdom of God without God. And in many ways, technology and education do improve our quality of life. But in times like these, we see that more gizmos and gadgets don't make us better. We are more affluent, more connected, and more knowledgeable than ever before. But have we progressed morally? The evidence on the ground suggests not. We live in a time when tribalism is on the rise, economic inequality is growing, and social division deepening. Historians have said that our era will be remembered as the age of genocide, with more people killed in violence than any other time in history. So it would be hard to make the claim that we are, in fact, progressing. And that's why I'm praying for the power of the Holy Spirit to do what only God can do. And as Christians, we look to the future with tremendous hope. Because we believe that in Jesus Christ, on Easter Sunday, God began a renewal program that is far more powerful than anything we might come up with. This morning, the Apostle Paul says, "I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith." That might sound like yet another personal improvement technique, but he's not done. "And I pray," he says, "that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long, high and deep is the love of Christ." That's all kind of mind-boggling to think about. And that's the amazing thing about the power of the Holy Spirit. It's always personal. But the personal experience of God leads us to a communal outpouring of the Spirit's power and love. And this outflowing of the power of love brings us collective renewal. But the renewal that the Holy Spirit brings isn't like the myth of progress. The Holy Spirit isn't slowly and steadily bringing renewal day by day, as if time itself will solve the world's problems. Instead, the Holy Spirit brings periods of renewal by joining with people who are committed to the renewing agenda of God. Throughout history, at different times, God's Holy Spirit has brought about powerful renewal in the midst of cultural and social despair. In North America, these periods of renewal seem to happen every 100 years or so. Back in the 18th century, there was a period of renewal that became known as the Great Awakening. It began primarily with a group of young adults in Northampton, Massachusetts, during a time of cultural, economic, and social shift from a communal society to a capitalist one. The strong community bonds that had historically forged meaning were fraying, the mental and spiritual health of the young adults deteriorating. Anxiety and depression were normative. Any of this sound familiar? And yet through the patient ministry of Jonathan Edwards primarily, the dramatic power of God would be displayed in that very time and place. They would be the front runners of a new movement that would spread across generational, economic, and ethnic lines. And what we learn from this period is that renewal occurs when people are most discouraged, when social bonds are breaking, and when the stories we once told to make sense of our reality no longer make sense. Again, any of that sound familiar? Because that's pretty much where we are today. People don't trust our communal story anymore. The ways of making sense of ourselves and our communities is disintegrating. It started long before COVID, but COVID made it all worse. It might seem like a hopeless time, but maybe it's making room for God to do what God does, to bring renewal. Some of you will remember the impact of the last period of great renewal. Early in the 20th century, there was the holiness movement that swept through this region. While it might seem kind of quaint today compared to 21st century ethical norms, the holiness movement was a powerful answer to the social degradation of the time. The other day, as we continued to clean out the Empey Hill Church, we found, tucked away in a forgotten corner, a pledge form signed by members of the church who were promising not to engage in the destructive behaviors that had become normative in their day. Quaint as it seems, It was a sign of the Holy Spirit bringing renewal in that time of social and economic deprivation. The Holy Spirit forming an alternative community inspired by an alternative vision of what the good life could look like. In many ways, the church we know and love today very much owes its existence to the powerful moves of the Holy Spirit in those times. But Mark Sayers says, much of the church today is operating on the kinetic forward motion of previous moves of God, standing on a platform built by the service and ministry of past and passing generations. However, the fuel tank is approaching empty. And I think that this means that our culture is ripe for a new, powerful renewal of the Holy Spirit. Renewal in our time won't look like the 18th century or the 19th century, but I believe that the Holy Spirit has a new set of gifts to offer us as we move not simply towards progress, but toward new creation. But there's a problem. Sayers goes on to say, we are yet to see humans fully transformed by God, and won't until heaven. Therefore, we are limited by a lack of imagination of what can be in Christ, and we make this lack of imagination authoritative. This is the biggest challenge the church faces in this day and age. Modernism has shrunk our imaginations. It seems that only what is what can be. When we can't imagine anything different, we can become satisfied rather than hopeful. But when we open our minds to the possibility of the hidden power of God, we begin to see the possibilities of a whole new way to live. It's impossible to predict what the Holy Spirit might do next. But I wonder if the Spirit might just root and establish us in love once again, as Paul says. In a way, that will bring about the kind of renewal that our day and age needs most. What if we were to be a people not known for our political views or opinions on this or that, or known for our endless pursuit of happiness through individual quests for satisfaction, but people known for a very different way of being in the world? What if we, God's church in Selby and Empey Hill, were a sign to all the world of the power and possibilities of God to transcend this moment of cultural angst and anger and make us into people known for an awesome kind of love? Well, for that to happen, it will require us to lean into a very different way of being. It might mean we need to use our Facebook accounts and Twitter feeds in a way that builds others up rather than tears others down. We might need to be a kind of people who listen deeply to the issues our culture faces, but then not responding with blame or hate, but instead responding in love and grace. We might need to be a kind of people who put our faith in the next move of God, rather than the next move of our favorite political party. Today, the Apostle Paul encourages the church in Ephesus, saying, I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all fullness of God. This is God's plan for you and for me and for all of us together. The time is right for a renewal of God's people, for the Holy Spirit's hidden power to remake us in love. I hope that we, this little alternative community of God, formed by the power of the Holy Spirit in a different time of cultural challenge, can be people who wait with bated breath for the next move that the Spirit might make to fulfill His promises to make a whole new creation in love, and most amazingly, to use us to accomplish it. Come, Holy Spirit, come in power and love. Amen.
Spirit of God,
Church, pour out your presence, speak through your word. We pray in every nation, Christ be known, our hope and salvation, Christ alone. New power, new wine, as divisions fall, one church, one bride, Jesus, Lord of all, with one voice we cry, Spirit of God, breathe on your church.
Well, freely we have received, and freely we give. It's now time for our offering. And if you'd like to send your offering this morning, you can do so by mail, by e-transfer, or by joining our automatic banking option called PAR. And so with gratitude, I offer this simple blessing over all the gifts that we have received in this time. These are the work of our hands and the love of our hearts. May they be a blessing to this community and the wider world in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. Well, now it's time to join our hearts and minds together in prayer. And so I will pray as we normally do. We will lift up our gratitudes to God, and we'll thank God for the many blessings that we enjoy. Then we will pray for our community and our wider world. And of course, there is no shortage of things to be praying about these days. And finally, we will pray for the individuals that weigh on our hearts and minds. At each section, I will pause so that you can lift your own thoughts to God. Let's pray together. O gracious and gathering God, we give you thanks for this time of renewal, for this opportunity to be together from a distance. Lord, as we prepare to return to the normal lives of September seasons, we pray for your blessing on our plans. We pray that your Spirit will guide us, that your Spirit will enable us to enter into some kind of normal life in this fall season. Lord, we pray for your wisdom and your guidance as we prepare to return to church in a couple of weeks. Oh Lord, we come before you now with the many blessings that you have given us. Lord, we are a truly blessed people. It's easy to forget that in the midst of our challenges and struggles, but of course, every moment of every day is a gift. And so we come before you now with the big things and the little things that you have blessed us with in our lives today. And Lord, as they say, we read the newspapers, we watch the news, and we hear of so many challenges before us as a people. And so, Lord, we can't do this without you. We may try, and we may have the best of intentions, but we cannot bring about your kingdom without the King, without you and your Son and your Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, we come before you with the concerns about wildfires, global warming, apparently the result of our planet getting hotter and hotter. Lord, we pray for the situation in Afghanistan. We pray for refugees trying to escape that country in this time. Lord, we pray for the generosity of the privileged nations of which we are one. Lord, we pray for our political leaders in this political season. We pray that there will be wisdom, that there will not be the wrangling and the division that so often comes with that. Lord, we pray for the best possible leader to take our country into the next years ahead. Oh Lord, we lift up to you our Prime Minister, our Premier. We pray for our Mayor in this ongoing challenging time. We pray for business leaders. We pray for school board trustees and organizers. We pray for principals and teachers, all of those who are making plans for the season that lies ahead. And we pray for your blessing and guidance for them. Oh Lord, we lift up to you our neighbors, the Anglican parish of Tyendinnega. We pray for your blessing on them today as they gather and worship you. We think of all the churches in our community, each one facing their own struggles in this season. And we pray that you will enliven and renew your church in the months ahead. And so, Lord, we come before you with all of those concerns and the things that weigh on our individual hearts. And now we lift up the names of those who are continuing in their health challenges or their life circumstances that are in need of your healing mercies, O Lord. And so we come before you with the names that weigh on our hearts. And we pray for your peace, your strength, and your healing for all of these names. And Lord, we conclude our time of prayer, praying the prayer that Jesus prayed, the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, it has been a pleasure to be worshiping with you in these beautiful surroundings. Let's draw our worship to a close as we sing together. I feel the winds of God today. Let's sing. I'm so glad that you could join us again for this very special adventure. By the way, we did end up getting rained on, but that's okay. The sunset was made it all worthwhile. I hope that our time together has been nourishing for your soul. Next Sunday will be our last pre-recorded service, so we look forward to seeing you back here at the same time and in the same place as we kick off a new sermon series called Better Together. After that, we will be pivoting once again and learning a new way of being church together. Our churches will be opening for in-person worship on Sunday, September 12th, and our service will be live streamed at 9:45. You can catch it live or anytime after that on YouTube. So, looking forward to a God-filled week. Go with now with God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Go now in peace. Amen.